Hey everyone, Cayna here. Today I want to bring you one of our easy to follow Mythic dungeon guides. These guides are supposed to be short, easy to understand even if it's your first time in a dungeon and you're completing it on heroic or normal. Before I go into the video, I want to let you know there's a playlist in the description where you can find all the other guides of the series. Of course, please like the video, subscribe, enabling notifications to know when we upload, and leave any feedback you might have for this series in the comments below. The first important mob you need to know about is the Templar. The Templar has a passive 75% damage reduction to any nearby enemies. Make sure that you take this alone or with other Templars, as the effects do not stack or affect the other Templars. Know that this effect also affects things like explosive, so during explosive weeks make especially sure you do not pull these with big trash packs, as it makes killing explosives or other priority mobs extremely difficult. The next mob you need to know about is the Spiritualist. The Spiritualists have an aura that is whenever you interrupt one of their casts, they will gain a cast speed increase. This means that you do not want to interrupt any casts that are not very important. The two casts to take care of is Anchor of Binding. Anchor of Binding is just a thing on the ground that you have to dodge. These get thrown at ranged targets and do heavy damage when you get hit by them. The other one is Mending Rapids. This is just a heal that heals him and all his allies and leaves a very nasty hot on the targets. If this goes through, you need to purge it off, but preferably to make sure you interrupt it at all costs. A mob you only have to fight once in the instance is the Living Current. The Living Current is a big elemental that is extremely difficult to deal with. All the Living Current does is called Rising Tides. This will pull up everyone inside his line of sight, up in the air, and then smash him back down. This will stun every player for about 3 seconds, and the only way how to actually deal with this is by going line of sight of the target. This means that you want to tank the Living Current somewhere close to a wall or an edge, and then you manage to just run behind it and line of sight the cast to avoid getting knocked up. Your healer can dispel this while she's getting knocked down. This will mean that you will still fly up, still be stunned, but you will not take the falling damage where you get knocked down. Using personals or stuns on the two attendants that are with the Living Current before the cast is extremely useful to do. After clearing some more trash, you run into the first boss, Akusir. Akusir is a boss that has some very simple mechanics, and the main mechanic of the boss is that he will split into three and then do all his mechanics with the three adds. The first mechanic will be Choking Brine. Choking Brine is a simple debuff that goes out on one target. You can dispel this as the healer. When you dispel it, it will leave a lot of swirlies on the ground. Standing in these swirlies will apply the debuff to people who got hit again, so make sure that you avoid this at all costs. Searching Rush is a dash towards the target. This does extremely heavy damage and will knock you around. At higher levels of Tyrannical, you won't even get knocked around, you'll just get one shot, but at lower levels, you will get knocked around. You can also get knocked off the platform with this, so make sure you avoid this at all costs. Grasp of the Dead is basically a targeted route. You can stun this, fear this, you can do almost everything to it. Undertow is a cast that will go to a very specific player. This will slow them, do heavy single target damage, and try and knock them off a platform. Simply run against this and take some healer attention. At around 40 to 50% boss HP, the boss will split himself. These Arklings do the exact same mechanic, only they are happening 3 times at once right now. The main way how we deal with this is we will nuke down one add. This is because at a couple seconds into the phase, it will cause Searching Rush. Searching Rush still does a heavy amount of damage, and you want to make sure that preferably you would only want to have 2 of these go off instead of actually having to deal with 3, as that will become extremely difficult to deal with. When you kill all the Aqualings, the boss will return with very little HP. Simply finish the boss off and move on. The next mob you need to know about you will encounter is right after the first boss, and it's called Windspeaker Helldis. Windspeaker Helldis is a mini boss with 3 different casts. Wind Blast is some tank damage. You can interrupt this, and you want to interrupt this to avoid as much damage taken as possible. Minus Swiftness Ward is a haste rune. Anyone that stands in this gets a big amount of haste. This means enemy mobs as well as your allies. Make sure that you tank enemy mobs out of this to reduce cast times, and make sure that your allies stand in this to increase the overall damage done. Gale Winds is big AoE damage to the entire group. This is only a certain amount of pulses, but the boss standing in the minus Swiftness Ward will just make her cast it faster, aka it's a lot more burst damage. Again, make sure that you drag the Windspeaker out, interrupt the casts, and let the healer have some healing CDs. The next mini-boss is Runecarver Sorn. Runecarver Sorn only has 2 mechanics. You will place a minor reinforcement ward. This ward will reduce your damage taken by 75% of anyone who stands in it. Same with the haste rune, this is enemies and allies. Make sure that the enemies are out of it, and make sure your allies are in it. Cornflesh is a targeted ability that does massive amount of damage. You cannot live through this without the 75% damage reduction. As you can see right here, even with 75% damage reduction, it still brings me down pretty quickly with healer attention. Make sure that if this is targeted on you, at any point you stand in the rune, or you pop an immunity to survive it for a couple more seconds. The next mob you might encounter, and you very likely will encounter, is the Guardian Elemental. The Guardian Elemental is the elemental that stands on the bridge. In this video, we opt to skip it as it took quite a bit of time to kill it. However, the Guardian Elemental can be pretty easy to deal with. All he really does is put a debuff on a party member. Your healer wants to make sure that they dispel this before it does a tick. Other than that, he will do Shipbreaker Storm. This is a massive AoE pulse to the entire group. You can line of sight this, as you can see in the clip right now. However, obviously when you're line of sighting, you can't actually kill the mob. Your healer needs to be ready to do some very big HPS and have several cooldowns in order to keep your group up, as all this Guardian Elemental does is actually channel this. At high levels of Fortified, you might want to get some very big tricks going for this mob. But at the moment, you can generally face tank it and be fine. The next boss I will be talking about is Guildcaller Fire and Brother Ironhull. Both of the bosses have limited abilities and will do not share HP pools. Guildcaller Fire will cause Slicing Blast. This needs to be interrupted on a rotation. Every cast that goes through will leave a debuff on your party members that will increase the damage of the next cast that goes through by a significant amount. This is why I opt to get an interrupt Weakora and simply call interrupt on the rotation of who's interrupting. Other than that, you cast Swiftness Ward. This is again the haste rune that you saw from the first mini boss. Again, have your party members stand at this and drag the bosses out of it. This haste rune is quite a lot bigger than the one from the mini boss, so make sure that you do move the bosses a sizable amount. At some point, she will put a buff on herself, which means whenever you interrupt her, she will spawn the tornadoes. You can see the stars swirling around right now. This means the longer that she is up and the more you have to interrupt her, the more tornadoes she will spawn. As a very heavy melee group, this could become an issue. Brother Ironhull only has three abilities. Blessing of Ironsight makes him hit really, really hard, makes him move really, really slow. Your tank needs to kite him during this or pop some extremely heavy damage reductions. Taking things like Feather or Monk Speed can help immobile tanks like a DK, for example, kite this a lot. Other than that, Hindering Cleave is a big frontal that does massive damage and slows the tank. This of course makes kiting a lot harder, which is the main reason that you might need some speed ups for him. As this is a frontal and does extremely heavy damage, make sure that other melees or ranged DPS are never in front of this mob. Reinforcing Ward reduces the amount of damage taken and removes all debuffs. This means kiting the boss through the rune will remove all debuffs from your group as well. But when you play with like an Affliction Warlock, make sure you do not do this. The main way how to actually play this fight is that when the Guildcaller gets the buff, you want to stop interrupting her and instead stand with your entire group in the Reinforcing Rune. This means that the boss will not apply debuffs and you do not have to interrupt the boss to get tornadoes. However, so far of every fight that we've done, we've just kept interrupting her so she dies before too many tornadoes spawn. However, at higher tyrannical levels, this might be the way how you actually have to play the boss. Deep Sea Ritualists are very easy mobs to deal with, unless there are certain affixes. They have skeletons around them that have a massive absorb shield and all they do is hit the tank. You can Master Spell or Purge this shield off in order to kill her. On weaks like Bolstering, you want to make sure that you do not purge this shield off and instead get something like a Sub Rogue to kill the Ritualist extremely quickly before their skeletons die. Other Ritualist does it himself is do a Unending Darkness cast. This cast does big AoE damage to your entire group, and you want to make sure that you, just like the boss, interrupt this on the rotation. Other than that, he casts Void Seed. This puts a debuff on all players, but these debuffs have separate timers. Be close to each other, and have the guy with the debuff run out when his is about to expire. Right now we're looking at the bridge. This bridge is going to the third boss. This bridge is probably the hardest stretch of the entire dungeon. So in this case, we opt to skip it. And in pretty much every single run I've done of this dungeon, we've opted to skip this. Some of the mechanics that happen on this trash is Deflect Fast. This makes the mob dodge every single ability. This means, for example, your TKs cannot actually hit this mob as it will just dodge your Death Strike and you won't heal. Void Bolt does extremely heavy tank damage, which needs to be interrupted. Consuming Void is a caster spell that will put an Absorb Shield on the target, and then dealing damage to them will heal them instead. Touch of Drown is a debuff that needs to be dispelled as it starts drowning the target and does extremely heavy damage. A Mental Assault is a non-interruptible frontal stun that does also extremely heavy damage. All of these mobs require a stun rotation, heavy interrupts, and heavy amounts of dispels and purges. This is the reason that we opt to skip it. There is a lot of different threats in the dungeon that is a lot easier to play. Going to the third boss room, you see a lot of Abyss Dwellers. All this Abyss Dwellers cast is Lash. This does a bit of damage and leaves a stacking debuff on the targets it hits. This just increases the damage you take by everything else. This means if these packs are alive for a long period of time, you're gonna start taking extremely heavy damage. You can interrupt these, stun these, but you cannot do things like Mass Grip. Make sure that you assign some CCs, you have some AoE CDs, and quickly blow these up before the stacks get too much. The third boss is called Lord Stormsong. Lord Stormsong's main ability is that he spams Void Bolt. This does heavy tank damage. You want to make sure you have an interpretation for this, as reducing the tank damage is very nice. Waking off the Void spawns a lot of orbs that will gaze you down. Getting hit by these orbs will stun you and deal damage to you. These orbs are used for a different mechanic. This mechanic is called Ancient Mindbender. As you can see on my screen right now, this is the Ancient Mindbender. I'll be silenced for 20 seconds and I will have an Absorb Shield on top of me. My team has to break this shield in order for me to actually get rid of the silence. Having this cast go off completely will make you get mind controlled fully without being able to break it, and you will cause Shadow Bolt Folly. You want to make sure that the shield gets broken at all times. Soaking all the orbs will do heavy damage to you, so it makes this a lot easier. At high levels of Tyranicle, it's extremely difficult to actually break your target out. So you might want to do is jump into the pool behind me, as you can see right now, which you used to get through the fourth boss. This will deal extremely heavy damage to you and is extremely useful for breaking the mind control. You will end up dying and need a combat rest, but at the moment there's not many things you can do at higher level tyrannicals to actually break the people out. Note that you can actually pre-immune this, so mages can ice block, rogues can cloak, and the only real way how you can actually see if the boss is going for you is that the boss will look at you. It's not targeted. The boss itself though isn't too difficult outside of the break shield requirements. Simply interrupt, avoid the orbs, and when you get mind controlled, run through the orbs. Do know that your healer can also be mind controlled, so when your healer gets mind controlled, make sure that you get some off healing on your tank and that you do your interrupts very well. The next mobs will also be seen in the boss fight, so pay good attention to them. Sonic the Nizen does nothing but hit the tank very hard. You want to make sure that your tank has kiting this, or if you can tank it with some CDs. The Forgotten Denizen, all they do is cause Consume Essence. Consume Essence does a good amount of damage to your entire group, and it will heal the Forgotten for the amount of damage it does. Make sure that you interrupt this at all costs and have an interpretation up for it. The last boss is Falsif the Whisper, and is a very interesting boss to play, and in my opinion one of the more fun bosses to play. The main mechanic of the boss is Whispers of Power, which is a debuff that will prioritize the healer at first and then start going on DPS. This debuff reduces your max health by 10% and increases your damage done by 20% per stack, stacking up 9 times. That means at 9 stacks, you will have only 10% HP and deal 180% increased damage. This is the main mechanic of the boss that you have to play around with, as you can completely avoid taking any damage on this fight. The main damage that you will be taking during this fight will be in the intermission, which I will talk about in a bit, getting hit by tentacle slams, or the Azeroth evil spawning, which I will talk about in a bit, by killing them or them hitting the boss. As I mentioned, this boss is all about control, so I'll be talking about other mechanics now, just so you know what you have to deal with. Very quickly into the fight, the boss will cause Grasp of the Sunken City. This will send you into an intermission. In the intermission, there will be the adds that you saw before the boss. Two Forgotten Denizen, these will be for the DPS to deal with, as the group is split. The way how we do this is we send interrupt one ranged DPS on the one that's far in the back, and then we have all the DPS nuke one target. We have one DPS, save his interrupt for the second cast that comes through, and then the tank and the healer are downstairs dealing with the tank add. The fact that the healer has the DPS buff just means that the tank has the taunted add, and then the healer nukes the add down. Doing this with the 9 stacks should have the healer out extremely quickly, and the tank will be able to take the 4th interrupt that's needed in the DPS phase then. Having assigned interrupts beforehand is extremely useful, you want to make sure that you do this. Having a cast go through of the adds will simply mean that your healer gets one shot once it enters the phase, so make sure that you interrupt this at all costs. For the rest, the boss will cast Call of the Abyss. Call of the Abyss will spawn 5 adds that will start moving to the boss. These adds hitting the boss will give the boss 10 energy. When the boss reaches 100 energy, he will go into the next intermission phase. You want to make sure that you CC these adds, you can paralyze them, stun them, slow them, mass grip them, and do everything to them. This boss at higher levels of Tyrannical is very fun to play, as you're gonna have multiple debuffs and any mistake that you do will end up killing the boss. Remember, do not kill the adds, you cannot dot them and you cannot cleave them, as them dying will simply do a big explosion. Them running into the boss, aka you not controlling them properly, will also cause the explosion. Make sure you do everything in your power to not have the adds run into the boss. The two people with the debuffs should be nuking the boss. Avoid the tentacle slams and assign interrupts in the intermissions. Doing all of this will make the boss die extremely quickly, as you will have your healers be doing 18k DPS and out DPSing all your other DPS, as you can see in the DPS meter right now. Well, that rounds off this guide. Again, I'm Cayna. You can find all my socials in the video description, including my Twitch, where you're welcome to stop by and ask any questions you may have. We hope you've enjoyed the video. If you did, remember hit the like button, consider subscribing. Thank you for watching and have a great day.